I don't know about you, but I find there's always a lot to remember. So much so that I have to write things down on a whiteboard like this to keep prompting my memory, or store things on a computer to jog my memory so that the important things don't get forgotten. Every year we have a day set apart that we call Remembrance Sunday, November the 11th. And it's always celebrated on November the 11th to remember the fact that in 1918, which is over 100 years ago now, the largest war the world had ever seen came to an end, the First World War. Remembrance Sunday is all connected to that. Now, with everything that's going on with the COVID outbreak, means that unusually, instead of parades or memorials gathered around a war memorial, we are standing out on our doorstep, perhaps for a couple of minutes of silence, or like yourself watching this, just thinking about these things through the medium of YouTube or some other technology. But we are endeavoring to try to remember. That's the important thing. It's Remembrance Sunday. Lest we forget. You might sometimes see that written up on a poster that somebody might put up in their window. Lest we forget. There's a real concern that something important would be forgotten. Obviously, if you're a Welsh speaker, you might see a ragini anghofio. Lest we forget. That real concern that somehow something of great worth that's affected all of us in one way or another should be forgotten. And it is over 100 years ago now. As we look at these photographs, I have to ask myself a question. What do I actually remember? Because the truth is, as you can see from this photograph, the way people dress, the fact it's always in black and white, tells us how long ago this event actually was. It's more than 100 years. In our church, we have a wide range of people, different age groups, and the oldest of our folk, lovely lady, Mary, she's 101 years old, but even she wasn't born in the First World War. So whatever we have is things that have been passed on to us. They're not our actual memories. Even Mary doesn't actually have an actual memory of the war. What she remembers is stories and the effects of the war on her family and the country as she was growing up. People who remember the Second World War, which was the other big, enormous conflict, both of these involved millions of people losing their lives. And we would be very unwise to forget how many people were killed in these terrible conflicts, how much suffering, but also what was achieved by those sacrifices as well. But if you were to actually have a memory of the Second World War, you'd probably need to be over 80 years old now. The war ended 75 years ago, but nevertheless, 5 years old and up, perhaps you probably have your first memories. So there will be people who remember the Second World War, but only just, and you'd have to be in your 80s and in your 90s. I'm sure Mary has real memories of the Second World War herself. So you, speaking to the children in particular, you can't be expected to remember these things any more than I can. I wasn't born. I don't have any remembrance, personal memories of these things, just what I've been told. And this event every year jogs me to think about it, even though I wasn't a witness myself. Sadly, since those two great wars, there's also been a number of other wars that our country's been involved with. We got involved in a war in Korea. We got involved in a war or a conflict in Cyprus, in Aden as well. We also got involved in a terrible, long conflict in Northern Ireland. And beyond that as well, the Falklands, little islands off Argentina, which belong to us that we defended. But by comparison to those two big wars, especially the First World War, which was so shocking to everybody because of the scale of it, these other conflicts, however bitter and however real the suffering was of those who went through them, they are much smaller conflicts by comparison. It mostly in our lifetime, we've known a season of relative peace. And that's something to be thankful for, isn't it? And partly it's because we remember, it helps us to be sober, and that does help us to value peace. More recently, of course, there's been two big conflicts we've been involved with, one in Iraq and the other in Afghanistan. And these seem much closer to home, much more real to us. Perhaps I myself know people who fought in Afghanistan. I know people who fought in Iraq. I've met people, there are people amongst us today of our own generation who are still involved and are still serving in those places today. Very bitter, very troubling, difficult campaigns. Perhaps one of the differences about those conflicts than the First and Second World War was, to some extent, we went in a supportive role to another country, in this case, America. We played a supportive role to, it was an American war, if you will, which we supported, whereas the First and Second World War were wars that were very much our wars, where our own borders were directly threatened. So what do I actually remember? Well, I suppose these two more recent wars I will never forget from a more personal perspective. And this experience we're all having with the pandemic outbreak does feel like a conflict. It does feel like a battle. It does feel like a war. Thankfully, it isn't. And we've got to remember that. Sometimes we use the language of people being on the front line and our fight against COVID and so on. And yes, there is a real struggle, and I don't think you'll forget it, and we certainly won't forget it either. And we remember people who serve at this time. We remember the nurses and the doctors, and we remember the people who've got the difficult decisions to make. We remember the police. We remember each person who's making a personal sacrifice in order to enhance the overall good of our country and the world at this time. The people who are developing vaccines, we're so grateful for these things, but it is really good that this isn't actually a war. So what do I remember from all of these things? When I bring it all together, I remember actually important values more than anything else. I remember that through all of these times of conflict, people have to pull together. They have to work together. I remember that people have shown a great deal of cheerfulness even in the face of hardships and difficulty and suffering. I've remembered the fact that people have been extremely brave, and bravery is an excellent quality. I remember as well that people have had difficult choices to make, and they've striven to do the right thing. And doing the right thing remains to be a very important thing to try to do. I remember as well that in every conflict, in every fight, people get hurt. And that's a terrible thing. And that is a reason why we should do all we can to keep the peace and to remember that, yes, the sacrifices that people make in conflict, but the value of the peace that can be won by such times of sacrifice and trial. In the end, I suppose what I remember more than anything else is Jesus. Because Jesus provides for us the pattern for self-sacrifice, the pattern for service, the pattern that we need to build upon in our own lives. Greater love has no man than he lays down his life for his friends, we find recorded in John's Gospel, chapter 15 and verse 13. We need to remember that. We see it on the war memorials. That it is that which gives people the inspiration, the example, the pattern from which to find that self-sacrificing commitment that we need, each and every one of us, to overcome whatever challenges we find ourselves in. And Jesus, through his laying down of his life, has obtained for us such a victory. Through his sacrifice, we have life. And not just life in this world, but in the world to come through the forgiveness of sins, as he took upon himself the punishment that our sins deserved when he died on the cross. So what do you remember this Remembrance Sunday? What are you left with? What are your real impressions from all of these things? Let's just pray together and ask that God would help us all to appreciate and value the sacrifices that others have made for us, and help us to trust Christ so that we can make the sacrifices that we must make for the good of others. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us together at a time of remembrance. We want to particularly remember the Lord Jesus and his sacrifice for us, and draw strength from it, knowing that insofar as he has taken care of us, we are now free to think about taking care of others. And Lord, when we have to make sacrifices for the good of others, for the good of people, whether we know them or not, whether we like them or not, but just, Lord, because they are your creatures, we pray for the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ to help each one of us to do that. We want to particularly remember people who are in the services of all different forms, whether it's the armed services or the emergency services. We want to remember those, the medical services, and all people in every place who are providing a service of one form or another. And we ask, Lord, you'd help us to double down on our commitment of to service in the name of Jesus Christ for the greater good. Lord, trusting that whatever we have to give up for the greater good, we will receive back as a reward from your hand in the fullness of time. Lord, as we pattern our lives upon the Lord Jesus, help us to go in faith, in hope, and in love. And we pray in Jesus' name, keep us in your peace. Amen.
Now, if you have your Bible with you, or you're happy to follow the reading as I put it up on the screen, please won't you turn to the first epistle of the Apostle Peter, and the first chapter, so 1 Peter chapter 1, and I'm going to read to you from verse 3 down to verse 9, and afterwards just turn to one verse in the book of Romans. That's the book of Romans chapter 15 and verse 13, which is going to be the verse that Ben Slatter is going to preach from. So 1 Peter chapter 1 verses 3 to 9, followed by Romans chapter 15 and verse 13. This is the word of the Lord. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In all this, you greatly rejoice. Though now for a little while you may have to suffer grief of all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you're receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls. And so over to Romans 15 verse 13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. We've come to that part in the service where we would want to observe a 2-minute silence. And I want to encourage you to spend this 2 minutes in prayer, to remember particularly those who serve and serve in a way that puts their own lives at risk, sacrifices I suppose people are making and prepared to make, the families of those who have lost loved ones in the course of their duties for the sake of others. That's the point, isn't it? We want to honor the principle that Christ establishes of giving ourselves for the good of others, of all sorts. So let's pray. Thank you.
Despite the pandemic, people will be meeting today online or in socially distanced gatherings around war memorials in villages up and down the country to remember those sacrifices made by so many people in the armed forces so that we can enjoy the freedoms we have today, those freedoms we so easily take for granted. Today we remember the personal cost made by so many. There are the physical wounds of war. There are also the emotional and the mental scars of war, which can be life-changing for those individuals concerned and for their families. Today, we also remember, rightly, the horrors of war. Ernie Pyle, the Pulitzer Prize-winning war correspondent, when surrounded by death and suffering during World War II, he became deeply discouraged and he wrote these words to one of his friends. "I wish you'd shine any of your light in my direction. God knows I've run out of light." On a day like this, as we think about the horrors of war, we're reminded that our world is full of difficulty. It's full of distress. It's full of death. And people are often short of hope. Life doesn't feel worth living to so many. What is the point of it all? Do you ever feel like you're running out of light? Do you ever find yourself in a dark and a hopeless place? Well, today, I want to talk to you for a few moments about hope. I want to talk about why we need hope, where we can find it, and what it produces in our lives. Firstly, why do we need hope? Well, to get through life, we need to get through suffering. And to get through suffering, we need to have hope. Tim Keller, a preacher in New York, he talks about an interesting person called Viktor Frankl. Now, Viktor Frankl was an Austrian psychiatrist. He was also a Holocaust survivor. He wrote about his time in the death camps in a book called Man's Search for Meaning. Now, as a doctor and as a counsellor, he was interested in how people responded to their terrible suffering in the death camps. And in his book, he noted four ways that people responded to suffering. Firstly, he noted that people could get brutal. Even nice people, even his friends in the death camp, would often become cruel. They would begin to trample on anyone else to survive themselves. That's how the suffering and the death affected them. Secondly, he noticed that a lot of people, they simply gave up. They lay down and they lost all hope. And Frankl talks about the fear that he had that the day would come when one of his friends would just not get up in the morning, just refuse to move, refuse to get up, to just lay there in despair. He writes about someone in the death camp he was in who had a dream that the war would end on March the 30th. He thought it was a revelation, but as time went on and it got nearer and nearer to the date, everyone started to realize the dream was not going to come true. The war was not going to end. On March 29th, this man got a high temperature. On March 30th, his day, he lost consciousness. And on March 31st, he had died. Frankl wrote, "The loss of hope lowered his resistance to all the disease in the camp." So there were those who became brutal. There were those who gave up hope. Thirdly, Frankl noticed there was a group of people who believed if they could just hold on, if they could just cling on to life, if they could survive and get through this, then they could get all their hopes back in the future. And Frankl talks about their hopes being things like their family, their health, their professional achievements, their fortune, their position in society. If they could just cling on and get through, maybe all of that could be restored to them. But Frankl noted that after liberation, many of the people he knew became deeply depressed. Many had said in the camps, no earthly happiness could compensate for the kind of suffering we've experienced here and been through here, and yet they still couldn't prepare themselves for the disillusionment of returning to old hopes, but life just not being the same. Fourthly, Frankl noticed there was a very small group of people who somehow managed to keep their inner liberty. That's how he described it. They managed to have this inner strength which raised them above their sufferings and helped them to remain kind in all that they were facing rather than turning brutal. And it helped them to keep going rather than laying down and giving up. What made the difference? That's what interested Dr. Frankl, being a psychiatrist. And this is the conclusion that he came to. He said, life in a concentration camp tears open the soul and exposes its depths and foundations. Frankl would counsel people in the death camps by saying, life only has meaning if we have a hope and a meaning that suffering and death cannot destroy. People would come to him in the camp because he was a doctor for counsel, and he would say, he would just say to them, remember that someone is looking down on you from heaven, a friend, a wife, a spouse, or God, and we must not disappoint them. Now, Frankl noticed something really important. In the death camps, people needed a hope which suffering and death would not be able to destroy. They needed a hope to keep them kind and to keep them going through all the terrible suffering that they were facing. Now, we don't live in a death camp. We have been fortunate enough to be born into a wealthy country, a good time in history compared to other times in history, into a relatively stable and just society. But nonetheless, we too experience difficulty. We too experience distress in our lives. All of us have to go through the aging process. We have to experience decay. All of us suffer illness and hurt and grief and pain and difficulties and distress. And finally, death affects every one of us. We too need a hope which death and suffering cannot destroy, cannot take away from us. I have so many hopes for this life, and I think most of them are good hopes. Many of them are good hopes. I want my kids to do well at school. I want them to grow up healthy, to have a happy life. I want them to find a job which suits their gifts and their personality, a job where they make a difference and serve others. If they choose to get married when they're older, I want them to marry a kind person, someone they can serve God with. I personally have hopes for myself. I want to achieve some things in the next 10 years. I want to grow in some areas. I'd like to travel to a few places in the world with my family. I'd like to live a long and a happy life. I'd like to retire with my wife and enjoy each other's company together. I'd like to be a grandparent one day. I'd like to see the church where I serve grow in strength and in love. One of my hopes is that God would work in me, but also through me, to achieve some good in the time I have in this world. And there are many other hopes in my heart. But what is my ultimate hope? Because if I make my ultimate hope any finite object, any finite temporary thing, if I live for my job or my children or my bank balance or my looks or my health or my position in society or whatever it is, well, suffering and loss and ultimately death can and will strip those things away from me. If I live long enough, it's all going to go. So how can I live my life with purpose and with joy and with peace and with courage? How can I keep going and how can I keep staying kind through all the trials of life in this fallen world. All of us need an ultimate hope beyond finite stuff. All of us, me and you, we need, our souls, they need an ultimate hope beyond finite stuff. We need a hope that suffering and death cannot destroy. And there is such a hope. There really is such a hope. And it's available to anyone and to all of us. And I believe by the grace of God, I found that hope. Which brings me on to the second point. Where can we find this hope? Where can we find such a hope? You may be surprised to discover that the answer is in this forgotten book, the Bible. We find it in Romans chapter 15, verse 13, which says this: "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit." In this book, you discover a God not of gloom and doom, but of hope. And hope in the Bible, it's not wishful thinking. You know, I might say, and I do often say, I hope Spurs win at the weekend, or I might say, I hope the weather's good tomorrow, but I'm not certain they will win. I'm not certain the weather will be good. But when the Bible talks about hope, it's talking about something which is sure and steadfast and certain. Hope in this verse, hope in the Bible, is not a verb, it's a noun. It's not something we do, it's something we have. And what is this hope? Well, the Apostle Paul describes this hope in the letter to the Romans. In chapter 8, he says, "This hope is God himself and his love forever in a renewed creation." It's having that. He describes it as our full adoption and redemption as the children of God. This hope is what the Apostle John describes in the book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible, when he says in the future, one day there will be this union between heaven and earth, and God will wipe away our tears, and there will be a new creation where all who trust in Jesus will live with each other and with God, and there will be no more sadness there, no more sickness, no more sin, no more death. This hope is what Peter describes in his first chapter in his letter as an inheritance which will never spoil, never perish, never fade. It's an inheritance that's kept in heaven by God for everyone who trusts in Jesus, his son. And then Peter adds, "And all God's people who trust in Jesus are guarded and shielded by God's power until that day when they receive that inheritance from him." This hope is not something finite. It's not something which can be stripped away from us. It's not something which can be lost. This hope, this Christian hope which comes to us in Christ Jesus, is something which is eternal, and it's something which is safe and secure and guaranteed, whatever we have to face in our lives in this world. Well, how do we receive this amazing hope? Verse 13 tells us, it says, "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him." You receive this hope as you trust in this God of hope, as you trust in the salvation he has accomplished for you in his son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul has been describing this amazing salvation in Romans chapter 1 to Romans chapter 15. It's all a build up until he gets to this verse where he gives this blessing of hope, this prayer of hope to all the people, all the believers who are reading his letter. And in Romans, he describes how all of us have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And the wages of sin is death. When we stand before God, when we have to give an account to him, We deserve God's just condemnation. We deserve separation. We deserve wrath. But Paul goes on to say in Romans that the gift of God, the free, gracious, kind, loving gift of God, is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Paul says, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. This is undeserved kindness. At the cross, Jesus Christ suffered everything the human race deserves. Think about our record. Jesus faced our condemnation. He faced our judgment. And when we trust in him and we say sorry to him, not only do we receive his wonderful forgiveness and his wonderful cleansing, we also receive his perfect record. He is the righteous one, the sinless one, and we receive his faultless, perfect record, his righteousness. We are justified. We now have God's full approval because we're clothed in the righteousness of Christ. We're adopted into the family of God forever. Listen, Christianity is not trying to be good so we might get a reward from God one day, possibly in heaven. Christianity is knowing you are completely accepted on the basis of what Jesus Christ has done for you because you trust in him. And this salvation hope is offered to all. Paul writes in Romans, everyone, everyone, whoever you are, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Your condemnation will be removed and you will receive peace with God. Nothing will be able to separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus, not even death itself. We will be united to God forever. God will wipe away our tears. We will live in a new creation where there's no more sadness, no more sickness, no more sin, no more death. We will be welcomed into our home in eternal glory. And this inheritance, which never spoils, fades, or perishes, it's kept in heaven for you who trust in Christ. And what's more, God keeps you, he guards you, he shields you by his power until you reach that inheritance. This is the hope we need, Christian hope. This is a hope that no one can strip away from us. This is a hope which remains even in the face of terrible suffering and death itself. This is a hope which can keep us going and keep us kind as we travel through this fallen world on our way home to glory, to be with our God of peace forever. So put your hope in God and in his unfailing love. You're already putting your hope in something. Something is your ultimate hope for this life. Switch it, transfer it to God and his unfailing love for you in Christ. This is the only hope which will not let you down. This is the hope which will see you through this life and into eternity. Thirdly and finally, I just want to finish by talking for a few moments about what this hope produces in our lives. It has a dramatic effect on us, having this hope. Paul writes, as you trust in God, the God of hope, his Holy Spirit will work in your heart and he will fill you with all joy, all peace, and you will overflow, you will abound with hope. Now that word overflow, abound, means super added. It's the kind of word you'd use to describe the waves washing up on the beach continually, relentlessly washing and cleaning the sand. And Paul says, I pray that you would experience and know that kind of hope, because that hope is available to you in God and in Christ. And that's the kind of hope that me and you need today in our circumstances to combat all our gloominess. Paul also prays for this God not just to fill them with this overflowing, abounding hope, but also to fill them with all joy and peace. He's not just praying for a little squirt from an eyedropper in heaven of joy and peace. He is praying to the God of heaven to open up the tap and to fill his people right up with the joy and the peace of Christ. It's possible by the Holy Spirit working in our hearts, to experience sorrow and joy at the very same time. That's what the Bible says, that we can be sorrowful and rejoicing at the very same time. We can be grieving and hopeful at the very same time. We can be burdened and anxious and be finding rest for our souls in Christ at the very same time, as we believe, as we trust in Jesus and the good news of this gospel message, and as the Holy Spirit works in our hearts. And Paul is not just writing to bishops or leaders or super Christians. He's writing to ordinary, weak, normal people like me and like you, who are putting their faith in Christ. I don't know if you've seen the recent war film, 1917. It's a brilliant film, in my opinion. It's based, it's set around two characters, Blake and Schofield, and they're given this impossible task, really, of carrying a message through no man's land to another group of British soldiers who are about to be ambushed. And they've only got a certain amount of time to do it, and the film is shot in real time, so it's pretty gruesome. It's really intense. But if they don't make it, then 1,600 British soldiers, including Blake's brother, will be killed. The task is more like a suicide mission, but they respond to their orders with a firm salute and with obedience, and they get on with the job. Now, so in the trenches, on no man's land, in a desolate place, these two men are surrounded by suffering and death. And Schofield, he's completely beaten down. He's despairing, as you would expect him to be in such terrible circumstances. But Blake somehow is more hopeful. In one key part of the film, as they pass through an orchard of cherry trees, which have been chopped down and destroyed by the enemy, Schofield kind of expresses his misery, but Blake says, "They grow again when the stones rot. You'll end up with more trees than before." He has this kind of hope in him, which keeps him going. Later on in the film, a German plane crashes in the field where they're walking, and it kind of blows up, and they run over, and the pilot's screaming, and Schofield says, We should just put him out of his misery. We should kill him and shoot him. But Blake wants to show kindness to his enemy. They pull him out, and Blake sends Schofield to go and get some water from a well to help the enemy. Now, I'm not going to give any spoilers away, but there's one particular scene in this film which really stands out. There's this whole group of soldiers, and they're about to go over the top. They're about to be the first wave into no man's land. And they're about to face almost certain death. And they're sitting in a forest, and one of the soldiers stands up and he's singing a gospel song. And all these soldiers are completely quiet. It's incredibly peaceful. They're very sober. They have strangely peaceful faces as they listen to the lyrics of these songs, this song. And these words are likely to be the last words these men hear on this side of eternity. And the gospel song goes like this. "I am a poor, wayfaring stranger. I'm travelling through this world of woe. Yet there's no sickness, toil nor danger in that bright land to which I go. I'm going there to see my father. I'm going there no more to roam. I'm only going over Jordan. I'm only going over home. I know dark clouds will gather round me. I know my way is rough and steep, but golden fields lie just before me, where God's redeemed shall ever sleep. I am a poor, wayfaring stranger. I'm traveling through this world of woe, yet there's no sickness, toil, nor danger in that bright land to which I go. And the words of that gospel song help us to understand how these young men can cope with all the suffering and the nearness of death, the nearness of going over the top. How were they able to follow their duties and give so much in the few moments they had? Well, the truths of this gospel song were giving them perspective and giving them hope. A hope that not even suffering and death could strip them of. They understood that whether they, Blake certainly understood that whether he died young or he died old, everyone is just traveling through this world below. And the hope of that true home, the bright land, the beautiful golden fields of home just over Jordan, that is what kept Blake sane instead of being driven to despair by his suffering. That is what kept him kind instead of hard and cruel in everything he was going through. That is what kept him going through all the painful tasks rather than lying down and giving up. And that hope, the hope of Christ, the hope of an inheritance which will never perish, never spoil, never fade, is available for all. It's available for you and for me as we trust in Christ and the salvation he's accomplished for us. So may the God of hope fill you this week with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.